So, Bob, how did you get the nickname Bob? Coming from Connor.
Eli Scott was on the team.
Mater.
Yeah, I didn't have a nickname. And for some reason, he just coined the name one day and told me I looked like a Bobby. From what I understand, there's no rhyme or reason to it. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I don't, honestly, I'm not gonna lie, I can't remember the last time I called you or you by your real name.
I've never, like, Connor, like, just every time for dinner.
Like, what are we doing for dinner?
Yeah, I don't, it's weird to hear, you know,
it's strange.
Name.
Yeah.
But Bobby.
It's kind of, I like it better that way.
What's up, everybody? This is episode 6 of the Dogleg Show. Hope y'all enjoyed last week with Carson Beck, and hopefully in the future we get him on maybe some encore stuff, and then maybe just talking about, you know, his future with football. This week we had Bob Connor Creasy on, the SEC Golf for the Week. Yep. Kind of talked about how he got into golf and how he played last week and what he did well. And then we talked a little bit about Riviera and yeah.
And by the way, Carter can't join the show this week. He has to take care of some academics, so good on him.
Yeah, we'll see him next week.
Yeah,
yeah.
We got Connor Creasy here with us today, coming off a T3 finish at the Puerto Rico Classic.
Got the team win.
Yeah. Huge team win.
Shot 30 on the back nine.
Yeah.
He led the charge.
Everybody made some birdies, though.
Yeah, before we dig into that, though, Bob, tell us a little bit about yourself, where you're from.
From Abingdon, Virginia.
Okay.
Grew up there my whole life. It's my fifth year. Started here in 2019. Been a great time, but really looking forward to the last couple months. Gonna try and soak it all in.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So, was that your best finish in college?
It was, yes. Okay. Yeah.
Have you finished in top five before then? First one?
I don't think so. I think I finished sixth a couple times, seventh a couple times. Never in the top five, though.
Yeah. I guess now we can get into it.
Yeah.
Like Puerto Rico a little bit. Like, obviously, did you talk with Mookie, like, or anybody kind of being like, all right, like, we got to make a push here on the back nine? Because, like, when I saw, I think y'all were like 5 or 6 shots back, like, yeah, 9 holes to go.
And
was there like a change in your, like, I guess, approach or strategy? You're like, all right, like, I'm going to kind of push it here on the back nine and see what.
Yeah. No, to be honest, no. And that's one thing that I really like about, kind of what Mookie's preaching to us, is just, you know, not really looking into the results, just kind of being super committed to our routines. And, you know, the more we can do that for, you know, 54 holes and we look up at the end, we're going to find ourselves at the top a little bit more if we can, you know, fall into that routine and process a little bit more and be less result oriented. I think that was really helpful for us.
That's huge, because last year I think we struggled because we all kind of played within ourselves and we were kind of comparing each other. And
totally.
If we all played bad, we all played bad, and we all played good, we all won.
Yeah.
So it was nice to see everyone kind of have their moments throughout the week. And you only shot 2 under the first round, and then the second round, obviously you shot your best score. What was working for you in the second round there?
I just kind of played pretty clean, to be honest. I kept it in the fairway or right next to it, hit a couple of good irons, made a couple of like 15 footers, but you know how it is out there.
Yeah.
If you, you're going to have some good opportunities if the wind is not blowing too much.
Yeah, exactly.
And we played it last year too, so we kind of got a little better idea from that.
And you've had Mookie walking with you all day, and that was the first time. And I mean, I was telling him good round because he was walking with you all day, but
He was a ton of help.
Yeah, yeah. Does he help you with shots, or is it just distraction?
A little bit of both. So he walked with me every shot the second round. But he kind of just introduced this thing to me. It's actually on our Golf Metrics app.
Mm-hmm.
Like how you can rate your mental score after each shot from 1 to 5 or 0 to 5, whatever it may be.
Okay.
Yeah.
And he was just explaining it to me about how, like, obviously you want to have as many 5s as you can.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just that was kind of my only goal. I was just
like, after every shot.
After every shot, and we would talk about it for 5 seconds, and then, you know, we're not talking about golf until we get to the ball.
Mm-hmm.
But that's something that really helped me kind of just obviously stay more process oriented, not result oriented. Mm-hmm. Just seeing how many, you know, how many fives can I tally today?
Yeah.
And so that was super helpful.
I've done that before where I don't even keep score. Like, I just check off if I was committed or not. Not one through five, but it's either a check or an X, and you want to have as many check marks as you can.
Yeah, and sometimes it may not just be, obviously.
You do that, and you shoot 64.
Yeah, if you don't have to be. Obviously, it's more than just being committed. Like, obviously, you want to be, but, you know, you got to stick to your routine and, you know, same cadence every time. You want to just be as much of an athlete and as reactionary as you can.
Yeah, for sure.
And at what point did you know, like, we won? Because, like,
I kind of
finished before you, and I checked, and we were two ahead, and then you and Benny had to play 18 with the groups that were right behind us.
Mm-hmm.
When did you kind of know?
You know, I guess as soon as I got done, I looked.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, I believe we were one ahead of Virginia and maybe North Florida.
Yeah, sounds right.
And Benny was still on 18, obviously, with the North Florida guy.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And who else were we playing with?
Tennessee, yeah. They were right there, too.
Yeah, they were. And so I looked and I saw we were one ahead, but obviously it was a shotgun, so it's hard to tell. And even, you know, you don't even know if the scores are right.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, I mean, we thought we won, but it might have took 20 minutes for it to actually, I guess, kind of pan out.
Yeah.
But, I mean, it's so fun to win. I mean,
as
a team.
It is.
Individually, like, it's cool to see your stuff, you know, pay out, but as a team, I don't think anything beats that. Like,
we
won a couple
of
state championships in high school, and it was nothing like that. And then last year at regionals, it was like, you just get, like, kind of chills, like, you know, watching your teammates finish and playing the Puerto Rico Classic. Like, it's first one of the spring, but, like, just to, like, see it, you know, pay off and, like, actually win. Like, it's so hard to win with four scores counting. Like, it can turn
tough,
like that.
Exactly.
You need a lot of things to go right.
And I think this one was a little extra cool, just because I've never really had a team win come from behind. Kind of just won, you know, maybe leading after the second round, but this one or whatever it may be, but, you know, from what the coaches said, we were 10 down.
I said nine down at a point.
Nine down, so that felt that was just, that's just good to see, and felt good.
And it was kind of cool. Hacker kind of told us before the third round, it was after the second round on the beach there, he was like, I could care less if you guys win tomorrow. Like, it's just, you know, it's another step. We're going to get the momentum rolling. And I think that kind of just loosened a lot of us up, that we're just going to kind of play for each other, and that no matter what we shoot tomorrow, it's still a good week to build on.
Totally.
To go on to.
I mean, I was obviously at home, but I kind of mentioned it last week and stuff. But I actually went to the gym with Hummer, and then we were kind of talking about it and stuff like that. And then I started my workout, we were losing, I leave, and we win. So it happened very quick, but I mean, definitely it was cool. I mean, obviously, I think we've worked hard this spring, and I think this is a great, obviously, stepping stone for us to have a good spring and coming into championships, the SEC and the NCAA championships. So
totally.
Some good work. Definitely. Good work there, boys. So, Bob, you got honored, or you got the award of SEC Player of the Week because of your performance.
What a stud.
What a stud. Is that your...
Last week, the people asked us who's the best, or who's the most, like, ladies man on the team, and I said Bob, but now it's like, it's really, like, he's pulling away now. He's got SEC Player of the Week.
I mean, it was tough to get, just as hard to get Bob as it was Beck, for sure.
That's cap.
Come on now. But yeah, that's pretty cool.
Yeah, that is cool. Was that your first SC?
It was, yeah.
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 Let's go. Let's go.
Yeah. We don't need any Tennessee Neds getting that.
No,
we don't. No.
So obviously, we had qualifying this past, or I guess like yesterday or two days ago, it ended. But y'all go to Vegas next week, which is a fun one. That's definitely one that I hope I make next year for sure. Because there seems to be a lot of good and funny stories that come out of the Vegas trip for sure.
But golf course is fun, and stay right on the strip, and we didn't play that well last year, and hopefully we pick it up and get some better weather too.
I mean, y'all are my hottest team going into it off the win for sure, so I mean, I'm excited to see, like, how y'all do and play. Mm-hmm. I mean,
I think
Mookie's one for one.
Yeah.
One for one for Mook.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think playing last year, kind of getting a better idea of the course is going to be a big difference for us this year. Obviously, like you said, hopefully the weather's a little bit better. Last year, it was blowing. It was
windy
cold.
And cold.
Yeah, somebody told me it was like, did it snow or something?
It was close to
the practice round. We got a little bit of hail.
Hail. Yeah.
Oh, I remember.
We didn't even play the whole course.
Yeah, we played like 14 holes in the practice round.
We just went inside.
Packers like, I'm done if you guys are done.
Yeah. It's a neat little track.
Yeah. Makes you hit a lot of shots.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Drivable par four, a little water on the right.
Yeah.
That ninth green with like that backstop.
Yeah.
Like that's very strange, but.
Couple of good par threes.
Yeah. So Bob, how did you get the nickname Bob coming from Connor?
Yeah. All right. So I guess it was 2021. No. Spring of 2022.
Okay.
Eli Scott was on the team.
Mater.
Yeah. He was just, I didn't have a nickname. And for some reason, he just coined the name one day and told me I looked like a Bobby. And so it stuck. It's pretty quick.
Yeah.
Now it's just kind of caught on.
Yeah.
From what I understand, there's no rhyme or reason to it.
Mm-hmm. I mean, everyone kind of has a nickname on the team, so.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I don't, honestly, I'm not going to lie, I can't remember the last time I called you or you by your real name.
Yeah. I've never like, oh, Connor.
Like, it just
every time for dinner. Like, what are we doing for dinner?
Yeah, I don't, it's weird to hear, you know,
it's strange.
Yeah.
Name.
Yeah.
But Bobby. Funny.
It's kind of, I like it better that way.
Bobby Schmurda.
Yeah, too.
Yeah.
Sure. Ricky Bobby.
Bobby Schmurda.
Bobby Axelrod.
Oh, yeah. Bobby Axelrod.
Bobby Schmurda.
So we got a few questions this week again. Okay. You know, if you want to be featured on the show, send in your questions to the social media. First question this week, what is the best practice tips for juniors trying to play at the collegiate level?
Ooh, that's a good question.
All right,
that's tough.
You want to start it, Bob?
Yeah, sure. Best practice tips. I would definitely say work on your short game a ton.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say just play as many tournaments as you can.
Mm-hmm.
Well, did they say practice tips?
Yeah.
Practice tips?
But
put yourself under the gun as much as you can.
Yeah.
Obviously, you know, growing up, you know, from ages 10 to 15, let's say, it's more about reps and just kind of figuring out the game, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Obviously, you want good quality, but, you know,
yeah, like a lot of experience.
Just a ton.
Stuff.
Yeah, you're just trying to, you know, get as many reps as you can.
I mean, for me, like, my dad would always say, just like practice with a purpose a little bit. Like, kind of when you're going to practice, like, know you're going to practice a little bit, not like just messing around. I mean, that's good because that sometimes makes you sometimes creative around the green a little bit if you're just messing around. But, like, I mean, when you're going, like, you obviously want to practice with a goal in mind kind of thing, not just going out there whacking it for 45 minutes being like, all right, I'm going home and be like, did I really accomplish anything?
Or like stay out there for 6 hours and be like, oh, I practiced for 6 hours today.
Yeah.
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 That doesn't matter if it's not good practice.
Yeah,
and honestly, doing other things, like other sports too, like especially at like that age, I think it's important too, like whether it's, you know, even if you're going fishing, like you don't want to over practice.
That's
very important.
You can get burnt out very,
exactly.
very fast.
I think
sure.
you, I 100% yeah. agree.
I mean, I didn't play my first tournament until 8th grade. Which I don't know if that's
I think it's important to have other interests and not just focus on
other sports. Kind of just you learn so much,
especially if
helps your golf game
and being a team member, like in college.
Yeah.
All right.
Sweet. Which course plays harder here, the UGA golf course or Athens Country Club?
I mean, I think UGA for sure. I mean, I'd say that because, like, obviously UGA course is a little longer and stuff. And, like, the greens, it's a different grass, and it's kind of tough for me to read the greens.
They say which one's harder?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, UGA. So I'm going UGA, but, like, because, I mean, Athens, it fits my game for sure, like, kind of just a straight hitter and stuff like that. So I'll say UGA is harder for me, but, yeah.
Yeah, the scores during qualifying at Athens are a lot lower, but we also play two holes as par fives that could be played at par four.
Yeah, like number 10, 6. Yeah.
But, yeah, the scores are always higher out here, and just because it's longer and the first like six holes are pretty brutal out here.
Yeah. I catch some tough days kind of in the winter.
And it's, in the winter, ball does not go far. And it's wet.
Hitting five iron into one sometimes. That scores
four iron into 18.
Yeah, exactly.
Three sometimes wood. More.
Three times.
So, yeah, UGA course.
Who are some of your favorite people to play with when you go back home, and like who are some of your best like golfing foursomes that you've been a part of?
Yeah, so for me, I mean, obviously I have three brothers and a dad that all play, so that's always fun to go play with them a little bit. And then I have some high school buddies. That's always a fun time because it's definitely more laid back golf. Like we have speakers and stuff like that, so that's kind of like a good, I guess, release from like a like pressured situation, I guess. I mean, obviously we have fun out here and stuff, but you know, it's like when I go home and play with them, it's kind of more of just like a fun round of golf and not so serious, and it's a lot of fun for sure.
Yeah, I would say my high school buddies, most of the ones I play with still play in like D3 golf, so they know what they're doing, and it's nice to get a little game going and kind of fool around, like you said. And yeah, and then just a lot of people at my home club that will get a game going. Obviously, I have to give a lot of shots, but
yeah,
they try to make a game where I can't win, so it's not always fair for me. But
yeah,
just a lot of friends at the at the Brunswick Golf Club.
Yeah, same for me. Just it's always nice to, you know, kind of reconvene with your high school friends.
Mm-hmm. And, yeah.
You know, play a little bit. I play a lot with my coach when I'm at home, too.
Yeah, J-Funk.
Yeah, shout out J-Funk. It's always, like you said, it's just so relaxed, a little different. Mm-hmm. Just because, I don't know, obviously when we're here, like, everybody's just
grinding.
Yeah,
it's really, kind of a grind.
And it's just different because everybody's so good, right? Mm-hmm. But when you get back home, obviously there's just a lot of good players
it's
too.
Nice to see some bad shots.
Like they get upset. I'm like, you don't even practice.
Yeah, help with, help a friend's dealing with a 100-yard slice.
I would, adding on to that, I would say like a 4:30, 5 o'clock round, like
summertime, like
nothing beats.
Late afternoon. Yeah. Oh my gosh.
They even tee up like middle of summer. Tee up at like six,
six or seven. Yeah.
That's so nice.
Just play till dark.
Yeah.
All right, this is the last question. If you like had a chance to golf with one of the former UGA golf players that came through the program for like a final Sunday pairing, you get your choice of who you get to be paired with. Who are you picking?
I think everyone would probably say Kevin Kisner just because he's funny and stuff. But I met Russell Henley a few times, and he's a good guy. And I'd probably pick him.
Yeah, I'm looking I would probably play with Kisner for sure, and like in a final round pairing setting. But I mean, it'd be cool to play with almost all of them in the final round of a tournament or something. But yeah, I mean, I guess I'd pick Kis.
Yeah, obviously, you can't go wrong, right?
But yeah.
I think I'm going to go with Harris English.
Yeah.
I just kind of I like him a lot. A few times I've met him, he's been super nice to me. It's like the way he kind of goes about the game and super, you know, calm and.
And B-Todd.
B-Todd, Kurt.
I mean, there's a lot of good ones for sure.
There's a ton.
Yeah, so PGA Tour had its, was this the second elevated event?
I think so, yeah.
Yeah, second elevated event, Genesis at Riviera in Los Angeles. Tiger's the host. That was his first tournament back, but he didn't make it very far.
Didn't make it through two rounds.
He had the flu. So Hideki Matsuyama won, shot, 62 in the final round?
9 under.
Yeah, which is really good out there. I've never played Riviera, but I've heard it's not 62 easy for sure.
Bob S.
Yeah,
I played USAM.
Yeah, USAM, it was tough.
Yeah.
How bad was it in the USAM?
I mean, I was 17, so I obviously wasn't very developed, kind of an immature golfer at the time. Didn't really know how to work my way around a golf course, but it was tough. There's just some holes where if you don't drive it 310 down the middle, you know, it becomes very difficult.
Yeah, for sure. And then, like, obviously another headline was Spieth got DQ'd because he signed a scorecard wrong.
Yeah.
And I was wondering if any of y'all ever done that in a tournament?
No, but one of my teammates has. And
yeah, I've never done it, but I've known people who've done
coach
it.
Coach ripped it. Like, that's like his thing. Like, yeah. My old coach at UConn, mm-hmm. like, that's your one job. Like, get the scorecard in. And I think he signed for one higher or something like that, but it was still like a. Is it a two-shot penalty if you sign for one higher or something?
I don't know.
I don't think you get DQ'd if it's higher.
Yeah, I don't think you do either.
But he wasn't even like it.
I think you might just take the score. Actually, no, you probably get like a two-shot penalty, yeah, I think, for what it is. But
I haven't, but it's always. You see a lot of people in college, like, they haven't even like filled out their scorecard.
I'm kind of bad about that too. Like, luckily, some of the tournaments I played in the summer, like, I would have a caddy, and they would kind of just, like, help me out and do it. But, like, sometimes, like, I'll go 13 holes and be like, oh, gosh, I got to do some scores.
Yeah, I got a pretty good memory, so it's easy for me to remember, like, my dad. But, it's just doing online scoring, too, is hard because you got to keep up with both.
Yeah, that's whack.
I don't ever like to do online.
But Spieth said rules are rules, and he left. He obviously didn't mean to, but.
Yeah, I mean.
He said he had to go to the bathroom or something. Or
that's probably easy to say. He's probably doing fine.
He's fine.
He's fine.
He did play well, too, so.
Yeah, I mean, that did, He was, like, what, like in 12th or whatever when he got DQ'd or something?
Shot 66, I think, the first or second round.
Yeah. But that was what's kind of funny. He tweeted, he was like, at Hideki Matsuyama, great playing today.
Yeah, it's like,
make sure you double check.
Yeah, make sure you double check.
I mean, at least you found some humor in it.
Yeah, for sure.
And he's such a like good guy. Like, he wasn't like trying to cheat. Like, if it was like someone else, like.
You can't cheat on the PGA Tour, dude.
All right, well.
Hey, thank you, guys.
Bob, thanks for coming on.
It was a pleasure.
Always a pleasure. All right, guys, thanks for watching. Hope y'all enjoyed this episode. Please, as always, give us a follow on all of our social media accounts, and that's at the Dogleg Show. That's DAWG. It's a great episode talking to Connor. Got to see kind of a little bit his story and how he played at Puerto Rico. The guys leave on Friday to go to Las Vegas to try to win the second of the first two tournaments this year. And so excited for them. The guys are playing well. That's great. Thanks for tuning in, and see you next week.
See you next week.